In a previous, wildly popular video, I listed out all the reasons why you should be running your very own Bitcoin node. And in that video, I didn't stop to consider one very important question. What are you actually contributing to the Bitcoin network by doing so? Stick around because in this video, I'm going to explain all the actual ways that you contribute to the Bitcoin network when you run your very own node. Recently, I have been embroiled in a massive Twitter battle with the Bitcoin SV community, the folks who believe that Craig Wright is Satoshi Nakamoto. Not going to comment on that because I don't want to get sued. And they believe that big blocks are the answer, that SegWit and the limit on the block size to Bitcoin was the worst thing that ever happened, and on and on and on and on. And during my massive Twitter battle with these folks, one thing became very clear to me. First, that Bitcoin SV only has about 14 up-to-date nodes in the entire world, which is proof that big blocks are a problem and make it hard for everyday people to run a Bitcoin node, but also that many people out there, especially Bitcoin SV and big blockers, do not actually understand or appreciate just how much value Bitcoin nodes add to the network. A common misconception, and maybe one that you share, whether or not you're a big blocker, is the idea that if you don't mine Bitcoin, if you don't run a mining node that is actually hashing and doing the proof of work algorithm, then you're not actually doing anything to support the network, and that your node is really only useful for you. Now, I'm not going to deny that the majority of the benefit for running your very own node is personal. They are things like privacy, like having a better understanding of Bitcoin yourself, like taking self-custody, and all the other things that I outlined in this video, which you should definitely watch. Open a new tab, don't close this one, because the YouTube algorithm will do all kinds of weird stuff to me. But if you haven't watched that video, make sure that you do, because I outline all the reasons why you would want to run a Bitcoin node. But that does not mean that there are not myriad benefits to the Bitcoin network when you run your very own node. And so in this video, I want to explain that, not just to the Bitcoin SV community, because I'm never going to actually convince them, but I want to explain and really suss out this idea of what you contribute to the Bitcoin network by running your very own Bitcoin node. And it's important that we understand that this really is the big difference between big blockers, or people who believe that it's okay to have large blocks of 8 megabytes or 100 megabytes or a terabyte or whatever, and small blockers. The reason for this entire war was that certain people believed that it was very important that it be easy to run a Bitcoin node on very simple hardware such as a Raspberry Pi, for all the reasons that I'm going to outline below. And other people felt, as these Bitcoin SV people seem to feel, that it really doesn't matter to have hundreds or thousands or tens of thousands of nodes. It really doesn't matter if all the nodes are run on cloud architecture, as Bitcoin SV and Ethereum are. And it really doesn't matter if you have listening nodes, because they don't feel that those nodes actually do anything. So without any further ado, let's dive into the actual things that you contribute to the Bitcoin network when you run your very own node. Now, first and foremost, I'm going to start out with the really, really easy and obvious ones. One, because again, that YouTube algorithm, I want you to stick around for as long as possible. But two, because I want to first get out of the way the things that everyone already knows. You can use the chapters below if you want to skip. The first, and possibly depending on your thoughts and level of conspiracy theoriness, is going to be redundancy and decentralization. Bitcoin is a distributed network. A distributed ledger or blockchain works by having a full copy of the ledger in tens in the case of Bitcoin SV, or hundreds of thousands potentially in the case of Bitcoin, hundreds of thousands of copies of the entire ledger everywhere in the world. Now, this is important for a lot of different reasons, but the most important one is that it makes it pretty much impossible to destroy a blockchain. As long as one full copy remains online, or in the case of Blockstream, in space on a satellite, you cannot delete or destroy Bitcoin. Now, some people would say that there is no value to having those nodes, having them out there, but I would argue that we very likely could see a scenario in which Something like a virus or an attack takes down tens of thousands of nodes. It's probably unlikely at this point, but it could happen. We could definitely see a state-level actor, someone like China or a very authoritarian government, ban or take down or block the ports of a Bitcoin node in their country, taking down tens of thousands of nodes. And in the case of Bitcoin SV and Ethereum, someone like Amazon could very easily decide that they don't want to host this stuff anymore and just take them all offline. So having more and more Bitcoin nodes makes it a real serious game of whack-a-mole to try and take down the network. The more nodes we have, the more nodes you would have to take down if you were a government or a hacker or intelligence agency trying to take down the network. And so, yeah, it's probably very unlikely that your tiny little Raspberry Pi is going to be the seed from which the entire Bitcoin network regrows after a massive coordinated multi-government attack, but it's possible. And if every single person says, what am I going to do? And none of them run nodes, which is what's happening with Bitcoin SV, well, then where do we stand as a network? Each and every one of us have the option to provide that backup to the network, and each and every one of us make that very, very minuscule contribution when we do so. The next one, obviously, is going to be communication and distribution. Now, this isn't necessarily true of every single Bitcoin node, because as I understand it, things like Umbrel that you run on a Raspberry Pi are listening nodes only, meaning that they listen and download data but don't host it to other people necessarily. I'm not sure if that is true about Umbrel anymore, but I know that things like Bitcoin Core, Bitcoin Knots, Citadel, which I run, and other node softwares are not only listening nodes, but it's kind of an each one teach one scenario where each node downloads the blockchain and then serves it to many other nodes, making the network more available and helping permeate it throughout the world quickly and easily. Transactions have to be broadcast through nodes, and nodes connect to other nodes in a decentralized fashion to transmit transactions all over the world to miners who then work on that mempool. You see, nodes, not necessarily mining nodes, but every single node, including all of the nodes that we all run on our Raspberry Pi, are what are actually providing the communications infrastructure for the Bitcoin network to transact both in terms of transactions and in terms of distributing the information when a block is found. You can think of this a lot like the way a virus is distributed, where each person who contracts the virus then spreads it to 10 people who spread it to 10 people. Well, distributed networks work in a very, very similar way. And so when you run a Bitcoin node, you are helping communicate transactions and blocks to other nodes on the network, helping spread that information and providing the literal communications infrastructure for transacting and transmitting information throughout the world and the blockchain. By the way, if you're enjoying this video so far, I would super appreciate it if you smash the subscribe button and make sure to hit the bell icon so you actually see when new videos come out. I know a lot of you, about 65% of you, are not subscribed, but watch these videos every single week. A subscribe would mean the world to me. All right, now let's get into a little bit of the more heavy lifting of the service that the nodes provide to the network. And this is one that clearly the Bitcoin SV and Ethereum communities do not understand, and that is validation of work. When you set up something like an Umbrel or a Citadel, you might notice that your node displays an interface which tells you that it is validating each and every block. Now, what that means is that your little Raspberry Pi is actually hashing every set of transactions and every set of hashes of those transactions and every set of hashes of those hashes all the way up until a Merkle tree, and it is reforming the blockchain from square one, from the Genesis blockchain, hashing on top of hashing on top of hashing on top of hashing. And the reason it can do this is because it is incredibly easy to validate the work if you are given the answers, but incredibly hard to find the answers if you don't have them. And that's the difference between a validating and listening node and a mining node, which is actually doing the work. You see, it's very, very easy to validate that proof of work, and very, very hard to actually do the work. So yes, every single node on the planet, even your lowly Umbrel on a Raspberry Pi, is actually validating the work of the miners. And in this way, you are providing a valuable service because it is our job as users of Bitcoin to validate that the work is being done. You see, we can enforce the rules of the network and prevent the miners from colluding and doing funny stuff or creating a weird kind of soft or hard fork, because by not validating their transactions, we provide an economic disincentive for them to pull any funny business. You see, our node will reject any block that they mine that doesn't specifically follow our rules, meaning that any miner who doesn't play by the rules is either going to get their block orphaned, meaning they're going to have to now catch up and do all that work without getting any of the reward on the blockchain, or they are going to fork off into their own version of Bitcoin with basically no value. So yeah, every single one of the transactions is being validated on your node. And I know what you might say, and this is what the Bitcoin SV community says, is that the miners regulate themselves and they validate each other's work every time that they try to hash the next block. And that's all well and good. But do you really want the miners to have sole control? And do you really want a relatively small group of 15 or 20 mining pools to have the option to potentially collude and force through changes on our network? And that gets into a really, really important thing that, again, most people don't understand. You see, Bitcoin is not in the control of anybody. And folks like the BSV community seem to believe, and in their case, it may be true because no one actually runs nodes, but seem to believe that the miners control Bitcoin. They bring the hash power, they bring the electricity investment, they must control Bitcoin. And that simply isn't true in the presence of non-mining nodes. You see, I like to think of it as a system of checks and balances, similar to the way the US government is supposed to work, but doesn't actually. You have the legislative branch, the executive branch, and the judicial branch, and no one of them has unchecked power. You see, the president can't pass laws without Congress. Congress can't force through laws without risking the president vetoing, and none of them can actually do anything unless the judicial system upholds it. At least that's to the best of my understanding of the US broken legal system. The point here is the core developers, the people actually developing the Bitcoin software and all of the open source contributors cannot do anything unless the nodes decide to update their software. So the nodes, the everyday people running nodes, even if they're not mining nodes, are enforcing and actually voting every single time there is a change, whether or not we want to implement it. Likewise, the miners cannot push through blocks unless the nodes validate them. And so you have these three different parties: the miners, which are kind of like the paid security of the network. You have the nodes, which are kind of like the everyday citizens who vote on what's happening on the network and either approve or start a revolution. And then you have the developers, which are, I guess, kind of like government bodies or corporations, which are pushing out new innovations and hoping that those other two bodies are going to implement and approve. And each one of these has a certain amount of influence over the other two, but no one of them has any definitive control over what happens to Bitcoin unless the other two agree. And this leads me to my next point, which is the fact that the nodes can actually collaborate with the developers and force through changes if the miners don't agree. You see, the miners are the paid security of the Bitcoin network. They're in this for the money. And so sometimes there are situations where the miners may choose to do something that optimizes for their income at the expense of the benefit of the rest of us, whether that mean our ability to actually maintain our own privacy by running our own full nodes in the case of SegWit versus the big block argument, or if that means trying to limit the network in certain ways so that fees go up and they earn more. The miners are incentivized by money, and therefore we need to have a way to push through changes if we see that the developer community has come out with something that we all feel is an improvement to the user experience. Now, this might sound crazy. In fact, most people don't understand that the nodes actually have the power to push through and force the miners to implement changes. And in fact, it's already happened. Most people don't realize that SegWit, the actual change that led to changing our addresses, making the blockchain more efficient, expanding beyond the 1 megabyte limit, but not up to 8 megabytes or a simple variable change, that was actually pushed through by a mechanism called a user-activated soft fork. What happened is basically this. The miners didn't like this change. They wanted fees to go up. They wanted the New York agreement to go through, and they were optimizing to try and make more money off of us. But the developers came up with what most people would agree is a really, really smart solution, SegWit, removing the witness from the transactions to make the transactions smaller and rewriting the way that we price Bitcoin transactions and the limits on the size of the Bitcoin transaction were no longer by kilobytes or megabytes, but by transaction weight. Now, that's all very technical, but what you need to understand is that the community of people running Bitcoin nodes, the hardcore users and aficionados of Bitcoin, really liked this change, but the miners didn't want to go for it. So what happened is this. The nodes updated their software, effectively voting for the changes that the community, the developer community, was advocating, and the miners had a choice. They could keep forcing their lack of changes or their own changes and risk orphaning off, risk their blocks not being accepted by the majority of nodes on the network and basically having to do the work without getting any of the reward because none of the nodes would approve them, none of the nodes would recognize the work that they have proved, or they could fall in line. You all know what happened. The miners fell in line. We got SegWit. And today, a lot of the innovations and improvements on Bitcoin, such as Taproot, are evolutions of SegWit. I probably made a lot of mistakes there. I'm not a developer and I'm not a cryptographer, but that's the best of my understanding. Hit me in the comments below if I got that wrong. So yes, nodes have the ability to push through changes, and that is such an important thing in the same way that citizens need to have the way to impeach or fire public servants. Citizens need to have that voting mechanism to throw out corrupt government officials. Nodes are the exact same thing. We hold the miners in check, and we are the review board that the developers need to pass through if they want any change to happen, because we can at any time decide whether or not to update our node software. And by doing so, we vote on what happens with the future of Bitcoin. Now, there's just one last thing that a node benefits to the network, and this only applies to Lightning Network nodes, but that is, of course, providing routing payments on Layer 2, Bitcoin's Lightning Network, and of course, providing liquidity. When you set up a Lightning node, you put your own Bitcoin on the network, and you provide liquidity to people who need it. You are effectively becoming a bank, just in a much better system that works in a decentralized way without broken rules and without privilege and all those other things. Now, I talk a lot in many of my other videos, and you can check out this playlist on running a Bitcoin Lightning node if you'd like to learn more about that. But suffice it to say that if you run your node well, you will route payments. And that is the market speaking to the fact that you are providing a valuable service to people who want to make payments on the Lightning network. So, in conclusion, what does your Bitcoin node contribute to the network? Redundancy and decentralization. Communication and distribution, the actual communication of transactions and of blocks throughout the network. Validation of the work that the miners are doing. Keeping the miners accountable in this three-way system of checks and balances. And pushing through changes if the miners are not willing to do so. And of course, routing sats on the wonderful Lightning Network. Let me know in the comments below, did I miss anything or did I misspeak in any way? I would love to hear what you think the contribution of the nodes are, or if you think, like the BSV community, that mining nodes are the only ones that are valuable and non-mining nodes are effectively worthless. As always, thank you so much for liking, subscribing, commenting, and sharing these videos. It really makes a huge difference. I will see you in the next one.